Your friend of the strength of the peachy kimchi, yumma. What is it, body, hitchy? When I chuck the dairy, humma. When I chuck, make me holla. Appa, I'm a narco, jeeva, pinch and lynch, a cinch, a friend of the lynch around my neck. What a heck, I'm around. Put me a check, she taking a big stick to my chest there. Pop, pop, like a Glock. Representing the 213 and the 214, LA to Dallas, Texas. Korean cowboy gangsters with the kimbap, yakbap, ojingo with hip hop, pixel, mochi, melontang, chimpang, salong, tak, and a very hot shita. Dogs fucking loud, you know what's up? It's poor Shin Ta and the dog shut up.
This group's called Girls' Generation, one of the top groups in Korean K-pop history. And there used to be 9 members, but now there's 8 because one left and it was drama.
Oh, the one that went off on their own?
The one went on their own. And then this one's called Dear Santa, one of the top K-pop songs of 2015.
So her name's what? Yamanika Timberlake?
No.
The one that left?
No,
that goes off on their own?
I forgot the name of the one that left. I think it was Jessica. See, these K-pop fans are so crazy. Even if I get the name wrong, they'll kill me.
Oh, on okay. That.
But there's...
Oh, this is the Christmas one.
Yeah, there's, yeah, like 8 really hot...
I've only seen 3.
Like,
isn't it the
20,
same 3 that started?
20-something girls.
So basically, it's kind of like the... female Asian version of Menudo.
Maybe, yeah. For those who don't... explain Menudo for the young
Menudo
young
is
listeners.
The Latino group's young guys, like where Ricky Martin started. And then as they get older, they just bring in younger... They bring in younger guys.
They were all put together by the producers, and that's how like a lot of K-pop groups are. And they're letting a lot of people...
Well, that's right, yeah.
View them as like puppets.
They do that here in the States, though.
Yeah, that's true.
With the guy band, the boy bands, and what's that girl band right now? I feel like I've only seen 3.
No, they're all different.
Oh, they are?
Yeah.
Oh. Now, I'm not trying to say anything.
They're all different.
I'm not trying to say what everybody's thinking I'm saying.
One of them speaks English really well. She's from L.A., and she actually auditioned for Kollaboration, you know, the talent show that I started, and she, whenever they interview, they always give the English
See,
interview
it's,
to her.
But there's, oh, is it me? There's always just 3 in the shot, though. You see what I'm saying?
You know what? This might be one where it's just the main ones.
Yeah, see?
People have
I was seriously going, these 8 girls look a
you
lot
know what?
Alike.
Yeah, this one might be,
Thank you.
Oh, you're right. This one is just the 3.
See?
The TTS.
You were making me look racist,
you're right.
Dude.
You're right.
I was trying not to say that
this
they looked...
This is TTS of Girls' Generation. 3 of the 8.
See? Yeah.
This is crazy. The reason why it's crazy is because it used to be only like K-pop fans, but now a lot of like Latino, white, black
yeah.
kids, they are into K-pop. It's insane.
Are they into K-pop or are they into the girls?
Both.
Yeah.
But they're like nerdy kids.
But I mean, honestly, if like, let's just say you sent that to me, right?
Yeah.
And now and then like on YouTube or something. And then there's going to be more underneath, right? I'm going to watch those. I don't know what they're saying, number one.
Yeah.
You know, this place is haunted. You know that, right? That's trippy, dude. The door just opened. The door just opened and closed.
Yay, we're here. World famous.
If you're feeling me, sit still. If you're feeling me, sit still. Just sit, think, blink, stink, whatever it is.
Thank you.
Yeah, buddy. First one.
But first,
thanks for having me, man.
Podcast ever here. It's called the Pinche Kimchi Podcast.
Oh yeah, you know I like the pinche part.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Pinche Kimchi. Because
see, we could have done that together.
Well, we're doing it together.
No, but. No, but we could have done actually because the pinch. Wait, is there an Asian pinchy?
What do you mean?
Are you talking about the Spanish pinchy?
No, yeah, yeah, Spanish pinchy. Yeah,
okay,
yeah,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
yeah.
Okay,
like fucking kimchi.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Like
no, because what I'm saying is, if we did like a comedy show together, we could have still
called
done
pinchy kimchi.
The pinchy kimchi because it's like rice and beans.
Rice and beans.
We could have done that. But anyway.
You and Bobby did that, right? Rice
well,
and
Bobby
beans.
And I did that. Yeah, we did that tour. But I love the name.
Thank
so
you.
Congratulations, man.
Thank you.
Give
so
it up, everybody.
For the very first one.
Number one, dude.
For the very first one, I really am thankful you're here.
Thanks, brother. You well, thanks
are,
for having me.
No, you are in Korean, Hyung means like older brother.
I know, yeah.
And you have helped me the most out of every headliner.
Well, thanks, everyone. Dude.
No, for real.
Yeah. Well,
so,
we
I mean, just to run it down.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sure.
Just to document it. You've asked me to open for you three different times at actually more than that, but I can only make it three times.
You know what? You're right. I have asked you quite a few times, haven't I?
At the Laugh Factory in Vegas.
Yeah.
So we did, it's 7 days. We did 21 days there.
That's right.
Like probably half the time I brought my wife and my kids. So, you know, we had a great time. We drank a lot.
Yep.
Tropicana. And then I opened for you at Tempe, Arizona.
That's right. I forgot. I was going to remind you about and that one. That was great too.
I opened for you Laugh Factory Arizona in Scottsdale.
Now, just to clarify, the Tempe was the improv.
The Tempe improv
yeah, in Arizona, and then
Laugh Factory Scottsdale.
And then Laugh Factory Scottsdale.
There were a bunch I couldn't make, but
there's a bunch. I just asked you about the Ice House at the end of February, but you got something to do with your boy.
Yeah.
So yeah, dude. I mean, you know, I'm more than happy. Absolutely. I always thought when you were saying Hyung, how do you say it?
Hyung.
Oh, I thought you were telling me.
H-Y-U-N-G.
I saw it.
It's like ultimate respect, like
that's awesome.
My older brother. Like if in Korean culture, like if I were to pour for you, I would have to pour with two hands. If I pour with one hand, then you could be like, yo, you fucking disrespectful. Like, and I'm only supposed to like drink. I can't even face you while I'm drinking. Like I'm supposed to face away. And then if you wanted to smoke, immediately I should have a lighter ready for, it's like real, like true, like respect, like a Hyung. But then on the flip side, a Hyung takes care of you, protects you, like you know what I'm saying. If something goes down.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. It's like a real close.
Oh, that's interesting.
It takes a village.
Yeah.
You know, and so thank you.
Yeah, brother.
I feel like.
By the way, I just thought you kept saying I was hung. I didn't know it was Hyung. I thought you kept going, that's my boy, he's hung.
No,
that's what I thought you were
William.
Telling everybody
not
I was
William,
hung. No. William, you mean Walters.
No, William. No, William hung. Remember She Bang?
Oh, that's right. I knew that name sounded familiar. Okay.
And you've always given me tags. You've given me so many good tags that I've used. Like I would say like more than any other comedian ever. You've gave me a lot of good tags.
Yeah,
like
the
one where I talk about, by the way, this is how I love it, very organic, but this is Johnny Sanchez.
Oh yeah, you can do all
my favorite comedian, headliner all over the world, and really helped me a lot, took me under his wing. I've been here at Laugh Factory mostly hosting for like 10 years.
That's a lot.
Started with the open mic in 2003, 2004. Like waited like 6 hours every week Tuesday. Sometimes there'd be.
Oh, is that what you?
Yeah,
you did the whole standing in line thing.
It was the only open mic that I knew. So like I came here.
Yeah.
I worked at LA Times. I did sales. I would finish my sales. Come here every Tuesday. Come here every Tuesday. There would be fights. Like Felipe Esparza said, like, if it doesn't matter, someone put the list on because the most gangster guy would just tape it going, oh, fuck that. Like, and then everyone would just be like, okay. And I would just be like, oh shit. Like, because you get bumped back because some big guys would come. And then, you know, Jamie Masada had an Asian night here. He had a fight with, you know, the previous. You know.
That was Asian Invasion, wasn't it?
Yeah,
just called Asian Invasion?
Asian Invasion. Yeah. And then we know like, there was a female Asian comedian who I love. She was running it.
I remember that.
Yeah. And then when they got Jamie and her in December, Jamie said, hey, we have an opening. Can you start? How many people can you bring? And I just promoted my ass off. I brought like 300 people that Saturday.
Yeah. I remember all that. That was obviously right around 05 or 06?
04 was the beginning, and then I started hosting every week. Yeah, yeah.
But what year was that you started?
04 or 05 right there, yeah.
Yeah, so it's...
It's like 11, 12 years, yeah. But mostly hosting, most people, they do like 3-4 times a week. I'm just
you
doing
only
like one or twice
a
week.
It's
yeah,
tough.
Yeah, yeah.
And then we just recently talked about trying to, you know, you wanted to do your Friday night, like for instance tonight, do your 8 o'clock hosting
and then go,
and then
somewhere
and... Do a spot somewhere else.
Yeah, let's go hang. But I just want to say that. Thank you.
Well,
out of every headliner comedian, you know, there's there's been some dicks. I'm not gonna name any names, but there's been some total dicks to me. Yeah, but you've always been like cool to me, so thank you.
Yeah, buddy. Yeah, yeah. Well, it makes me feel good, man. It feels good when you
even though there's 10,000 podcasts and I don't even know who's gonna see this. At least for the people who are seeing this, I just want to let you guys know, I love Johnny. Thank you.
Love you too, bro. Yeah, yeah. Otherwise, and you know, I really gravitated towards you early on. I liked your style, I liked your stand-up, and then I really liked you. And that's really more important than anything. I mean, there's some stand-ups where I like their stuff, and I respect their material, but I wouldn't want to hang out with them. You know what I mean? That's just the truth.
Yeah, yeah.
And hey, listen, I'm sure there's guys that feel that way about me. They're probably like, you know, love my material or don't or whatever, but they don't want to hang out with me.
I love partying with you.
Yeah, we have a lot of fun. I know. And
my wife loves you, you met my family and everybody, it's all good.
Well, that's the other thing I was going to say. Remember, you helped me out. Remember when I came back into town, I was in a tough situation about a year and a half ago, and you let me crash at your place for, was it a day or two? And I just needed, which was like, I mean, you know, I didn't know what was going on, man. I mean, that was a rough time, dude. And because at that time, when I look back now at that time, I really didn't know what was going on in my life and with certain things that happened in your personal life. And now in hindsight, I kind of, you know, it's like, I wish I'd have known more what was going on in my life with my situation. But at the same time, I stayed with you. I stayed with Jay Davis. I stayed with Raj Sharma, and then much later on, I ended up, staying with Ahmed. So, you know, those are things like you never forget them. It doesn't matter if it's only one, two, three here or there. I mean, Jay Davis, I think I only stayed with Jay like a day or two. Same thing. But when you're in a situation where you don't have anywhere to stay, that's a huge deal, dude. So thank you for that, by the way. Thank you. So you returned it tenfold.
You're welcome. I always tell Tammy, my wife, when I'm hanging out late here at Laugh Factory on Friday, if it's you, then she goes, oh, okay, cool. Like, she's always like, Johnny, how's he doing? Yeah. You know? And so, like, she's always cool. And the crazy thing is, to encourage anybody out there, I used to see your name up on here and different comedy clubs too, and then to hang out. That's the craziest thing about this is, like, even though I might never ever become household name or famous or anything, like, if you just work hard and just keep going, like, you just meet cool people, and it's cool, man.
I think at the end of the day,
because everybody is so, there's so many bitter people, and I'm just like, so many bitter, dude, I'm just happy to be here. Like,
yeah. You know? And and even if for people who get into this, I'm talking specifically stand up. I'm not talking acting and all that other stuff, because stand ups, it's a separate entity from sketch people and actors. It's brutal. It's way tougher. Just like that theatrical acting director I met one time. And this is when my wife was doing a couple of his plays, and he was in awe of stand-ups. Okay, so he said it's something he could never do. He doesn't know how we do it. He goes, he even said most of the people that he worked with as actors could never do it. I mean, some of the great actors out there, like De Niro and Pacino and all these guys, have said they would be petrified to walk on stage and do what we do. You know,
That's crazy because I can't act. You know, that's crazy.
Well, you know, yeah, we can't do what they, you know, as well as what they do. But
no, you can.
But but you know, he. I remember him saying, "He goes, oh, it's a rough, nasty business you're in, stand up. It's cutthroat." He goes, and you can tell because of the words you guys use. When you guys gonna go up and do great shows, you say, I kill, I murder, I destroy, I annihilated, I crushed. And I never noticed this. Because we're around each other all the time.
Yeah, yeah. But you know why I love you? Because you don't do that even when you crush and destroy. That's what I realized. My favorite headliners are the ones that kill, and they just are cool about it. They're not like, you know, that's like...
Yeah. And then how about the ones who...
Because Felipe said, how come it's always the fool that, like, it's not, that bombs, but he starts giving you texts for your jokes? Yeah. You're like, what the fuck? Like, I don't even, I'm not even that big, and I did better than you, and you're like, what the hell? Like,
And not only that, it's there are certain, and I don't know what this is, because you know what, like, you know.
By the way, I'm buzzed.
My buddy Ruben Paul and I, you know, we talk about this a lot too.
Love
it. It's interesting that there are these certain comedians that I guess, or maybe their bar is here. And some of us, our bar is set here when it comes to sets. I don't know if that's what it is, but everybody's in the room and everybody knows this person just did okay. Now, how could this comic not hear that the laughs were all right, mediocre, but yet they'll walk off stage and somebody else will come walking up to you, hey, I missed you, man, how'd it go? And, you know, you're kind of thinking he's going to tell him it went okay, I had him and I lost him. No, just rocked it, man. Just absolutely destroyed. What? We were in the same, you know, it's almost like your joke with a person who laughs and nudges. I'm here with you in the same show. You don't have to laugh with me. Same thing with that. You want to go, I just watched you, but I've noticed that it's consistently the same comedians. Yeah. So I realize there's no, when they really do kill, they go, I killed it, dude, I crushed. When they're down here and it's an awful crowd and everybody's struggling, they say the same thing. And I realize they don't have any type of gauge or barometer.
It could be good or bad, though. Could be good, bad. Yeah, if they're actually good, it could be good. They're just like.
But there's just something that some. I don't know if it's a mind over matter or they just tell themselves, I'm just good all the time, no matter what. I'm not like that. Matter of fact, sometimes I think I'm too hard on myself. Where
I definitely think
my comedian friends will come up, or if not you or some of the other guys, going, dude, great. I'm like, no, man, I had that pocket. In the right around,
I remember when you said you used to perform with his chubby white dude, very famous Louis. And he would crush.
Well, he'd be happy that you used. Oh
yeah, no, he would crush. But there'll be one guy,
the one dude in the front.
And every time you told me that story, if I were here at Laugh Factory, and there's just one
arms
Asian
crossed
guy. And I, in my mind, when I go off, even though I do okay, I walk off going, hated it, my mind, because you tell me about Lou.
But let me establish, too, though. We're not talking about a comedy club here.
Yeah.
We're talking about 1,500 to 2,000. Well, it was dependent on what. But it was never under 1,500, and it was usually up to 2,500 theater seats.
Seaters
that we were doing. So that's a different dynamic in itself, because we're talking about... There's 1,999 people that are buckled over, but there's one dude in the front like this that just what irritated him so much that it drove him crazy. And I get it too. I would do shows for him, and I always thought it was me because they were there to see him, and I was the opening act. But then later on, he'd be like, "Yeah, that guy with the cowboy hat, that son of a bitch, he's a fucking high roller, is what he is." Asshole. And I'd go, but it's
you should
true.
Do more impressions on stage. They're so good.
Well, I'm not like a Jonathan Kite. And
yeah, well, and, no, but and, you when you're just hanging out though.
Yeah, but see, you know what I think? But here's the problem. When I'm doing it with you, when we're doing it, it's such in a relaxed environment.
Yeah.
But then to formulate, I mean, look at Jeff Richards and Jonathan Kite. They got to really put effort. They got to put a bit together.
Yeah.
Because if you just do it. Although I will say this, this shows you the mentality of the Las Vegas audiences. One time, Carlos Alas Rocky. Do you know Carlos from Reno 911?
And I think so. Yeah.
Well, he was a Taco Bell dog. He's done numerous voiceovers. But he was working with. He told me he was in Vegas one time, and he was working with somebody, some other comic. He goes, they were just kind of looking in the back, like, God, these Vegas audiences. You can do any type of. You know, song and dance and little pony show, and they go crazy.
So
you know what he did? Before he went on stage, he told his comedian, the comic he was working with, he goes, watch this. I'm going to go up there. This isn't even a bit. I'm just going to do these impressions of these famous people playing poker. And he just went on stage, didn't write anything, didn't even have any punchlines. Just went up, and he's like doing De Niro, you're going to hit me, and he does, but hold on, he does, but you know, applause break.
Loved it. People loved it, huh?
He goes, there was not even a joke in there. They just went crazy that he did like four celebrities playing poker with each other.
Yeah.
And that, we know how that is in Vegas.
Yeah.
It can be, they do like a little song and dance a little bit. you know?
I got no skills in imitating people. That's why I'm so jealous. It's such a, you know?
Yeah.
There's like the Chris Rock. He never imitates anybody. He's like one of the best, you know?
You don't have to. No. You don't have to. See, I'm a bigger fan with a Pryor because Pryor did original characters.
Characters.
So, you know, that's what I like to do.
Yeah.
I'd rather just do characters than impressions because I feel like there have been so many good impressions, dude, over the years. Like, you got to be like, I mean, look at Caliendo.
Yeah.
Frank Caliendo is like...
So good.
I don't even know if who's going to... I mean, it was... there's been a lot in between.
Yeah, yeah.
But it was Rich Little for decades.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, here comes Frank Caliendo.
Yeah.
And takes it to... I think he did more... he may have done more voices than... I think he said he's got 100 or something in his catalog.
Yeah, yeah.
That's crazy.
That's crazy, yeah, yeah.
So, I was going to say something about... We were talking about something earlier... And I was going to tell you, that's what it was. Okay, so the documentary, and everybody should watch this documentary, Richard Pryor, Icon. Now, in that documentary, some of his friends were talking about how Pryor was real humble, and he was hard on himself. And then one guy was talking about, man, these comics today always walking around going, I crush, I kill. I go, yeah. You don't see it until you see Richard Pryor in the main room with the comics. He said, but even when Pryor would crush... and kill it, murder it, crowd in a frenzy, and he'd walk off stage, and they'd come up to him, they'd go, man, Richard, you killed it! And Richard would go, I'll get him next time, man. Because he was always trying, and that's what every comic should say. Yeah. Every comic should say, I'll get him next time. Or, you know what, that was okay, but I'm going to get better. I'm going to have a better set than that. If you think I killed, then I'll do better. Rather than what we see more often than anything, it's the opposite. It's... we used to always love the comics that, you know, they had a great set. So like maybe four or five people stood up when they left. So like one table, maybe, and they come running upstairs. Did you see that? I just got a standing ovation. All out of breath. And we're like, no.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Five people. That's not a standing O. A standing O is the room.
Yeah.
Stands. And that's, you know, come on. But everybody is everybody's self-padding, but it's a different day and age. It's almost like you have to. Like, yeah. I mean, I see people who are starting out in comedy, and they're taking all these shots at these guys. I'm like, they're just they just started on the road hosting or emceeing. I mean, back in the day, dude, it was like...
A lot of people have credits that they don't even have... There's not even real credits. Yeah,
real credits, yeah, and, yeah. You know. And then here's the funny thing. All we wanted was credits when we started.
Yeah.
Then you get to the point where you accumulate a lot of credits, and then all of a sudden people are like, hey, what do you want me to say? You want me to bring up this? And nah, just say Showtime, man. That's good enough. After all these years of accumulating all these credits, and what do? We don't even use them half the time. But when we were starting out, I remember just going, I just want a TV credit. I remember getting a TV credit, and then I got a second one, and then I was like, oh my, you know. And then something happens somewhere where you just kind of go, because we never liked the comic when the host went, you know this, when a host goes, what do you want me to say about you?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Just did an appearance on Weeds, Comedy Central, Showtime, a writer on, you know, and they start giving you this list of credits, and everybody just goes, douchey.
Yeah. One thing that I always admired is I remember when we were at Vegas, at the Laugh Factory in Vegas, I would watch you every single show, right? You know, you let me feature.
Yeah.
So it's 14 shows. And I would see you tweak and work a bit. And then you would bring out some stuff, you know, because I've known you, I've seen you for like 10 years, but then you've been doing it for so much longer.
Another 10, yeah.
So you just pull out like some... toy bit or horse bit.
Yeah, I remember that.
Where I'm like, whoa, where you could just, and I feel like headliner comedians, they sometimes forget bits they even had that are amazing.
Yeah.
So I just feel like, wow, they should just once in a while kind of.
I know. It's so funny you said that. It's so weird you're bringing this out.
Yeah, yeah.
Today, what was I was driving back from somewhere today, and for some reason, something clicked on all the kid stuff I used to do, all the stuff on toys and the carnival and the roller coaster bumper cars and all that stuff. And I said, I was like, you know, I should pull that out one of these. Like, maybe tomorrow night in Long Beach at the Laugh Factory, because it's kind of out of L.A. You know what I mean? And you feel like you can do an old bit there without anybody going. Like, if I feel if I do it here in L.A. or in Hollywood, I feel like some comic that I knew from way back happens to be visiting is going to walk up going, "You're still doing that bit?"
Yeah.
That happened to me one time. Somebody asked me to do parking in my parking, my old
version. Love that bit.
And
I love that bit.
I rarely do it. But it just so happens that a comic that I hadn't seen in 15 years happened to be there that night.
Yeah.
And I walk up, and then he's like, "Dude, you're still doing parking in my park." I was like, "No, man. It's one of the comics wanted this." Like, you know, so real weird. You want to do these old things, but you're always a little leery that some comic's going to see you and come up and give you shit for... I mean, that's just the way it is, dude. It's unfortunately... And then if you try to explain yourself, right...
Fuck them, though.
Yeah.
Because I've seen people jack your bits. Jack your bits.
Yeah, I know. I remember...
I'll leave that alone.
She'll remain nameless, right? But she used to work here. She was the manager here. And I remember her telling me, she's like, "Johnny, you are the most ripped off minority comic by mostly all the minority comics." She goes, "It's crazy. I'll see you do stuff, and then I just will see these ethnic comics have stuff so similar to yours, and we know where it's coming from, but they just tweak it enough, or they'll change just where." I mean, we all know,
I think it's because most of the time you're very nice. But one time in Vegas, I don't know if you remember this. This tall white dude was drunk, and he just stood up and started heckling you. And
this is
the only time I've ever seen you break out of character, ever.
Yeah, I remember
you just
that.
Went, "Oh, fuck you up. I'll meet you outside after the show." And I went, "Oh, shit. Oh, shit."
Yeah, I forgot.
And you went, "I'll fuck you up." And it was like all of your... And everybody went, "Oh, shit." And then you went right back into your next bit.
I remember
and you were
that.
Still killing. But that guy sat back down and he was confused, like, whoa.
But CPK.
But he was heckling and he goes, "I'm 6'4".
Yeah, remember that.
Just stupid.
I'm 6'4".
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah,
just something stupid, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And listen, I've had my scraps with dudes that are really tall back in the day or whatever. And then listen, I'm not saying that I would have won, but you
there was another time you kept it so cool here at the Hollywood one. Right. You were just chilling.
Oh, that one I know because...
And the bouncer tackled him and I grabbed his leg.
He grabbed his leg. He was on something.
Like Jeff Van Gundy or something. Yeah, yeah.
That guy was on something, so everybody knows. I mean, here's what's weird. It was a family. And then he ends up shoving his mom to the ground outside. And then he starts punching out. He and his cousin get into a fist fight. I mean, this is the level of people... This is what people don't understand about stand-up.
Yeah, yeah.
This is what we have to deal with. Family visiting from probably San Bernardino or Riverside. I think they were from out in the east area of the, you know, L.A. or the Southern California area. He was drunk and tweaking or something. He was on something. His girl was wasted. Because I remember when you guys were, they were holding, tackling him, and then you were... I remember his mom looking at me going, "I'm so sorry." She said that because she was, you know. So then whatever, mayhem ensues. I don't know if you remember. Remember the audience going, "Jerry, Jerry." And then I'm going with him. And then I see Jamie was the owner, go, "Get off the stage. Get out of there, buddy. Get the," you know. I go outside. I run into the guy. Remember? I guess he doesn't recognize me. I think, here we go. It's going to go down. He just went, "I don't know what happened in there." Next thing I know, the dad's holding him going, "Hey, man, you can't." And then the mom's like, "I can't believe it." And I turn my back. I just look back and I go, I'm walking across the street and I hear, "Oh," her voice. And I turn as she's heading to the ground and he shoved his mom. And then his dad's like, "You know, I'll whoop your ass right now." And then he's like, "Go ahead, dad." You know, that kind of stuff, that kind of family. And then the cousin stepped in, was like, "Don't worry about it, Uncle So-and-so." And then those two started fighting.
Yeah.
It's just, and see, but here's the thing. You go, you're not going to see that at the theater. You're not going to see that at the theatre. You're not going to see that at the ballet.
Yeah, yeah.
Or at the opera. We have to deal with that. You know, people have this, they're drinking. See, these other places, people aren't getting hammered. And there's a low respect level for comics.
Yep.
They go up there, Yeah, all right.
Everybody thinks they can do it.
And everybody thinks they can do it. And I wish, it's almost like, I wish there was just some way of, I don't know, there's having like having people get arrested. Like, listen, if somebody heckles, they get arrested. The only way they're going to get out of jail is they have to go up and do stand-up that night. Because then they would see, by the way, have you ever seen one of, this has happened a few times too, where sometimes somebody's heckling, you think you can do this shit, dude?
Come up,
and they bring them up, and then they don't know what to do.
Horrible. So one time Jamie was here, I don't think you're here that night, and I love, you know, by the way, Jamie Masada, founder, owner of the Laugh Factory, who I owe my
hugs and quiches. What does
my
he say?
Comedy crew. Hugs and niches or something.
Oh, niches. Hugs and niches.
One night this guy was like mouthing off, and he had like a beautiful girlfriend, this white dude. And Jamie, I don't know, he was in a mood. I don't think he normally would do this, but it was like a small crowd, and he just put him up. And he ate ass, like he just ate, it was, and I was delighted. Like normally I would be like, but it was just.
It's the best.
Yes, because people think it's so hard.
You know, I'm sure people have seen it on the internet and stuff. There are instances of somebody walking on stage and somebody getting punched. And, you know, I mean, sometimes comics have to defend themselves.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, and this is the thing that people don't understand. And this is good for people to know. You cannot walk on that stage.
Yeah, yeah.
And the moment you set a foot on that stage, it's the comic has to protect
itself.
It's
like Ron Artest in Detroit when the fans came down to
Jermaine. There's a zone, dude, with the and if you, I mean, for anybody listening, and you know what? It's almost one of these things. We have been through so many hecklers through the years. That when somebody finally decides to come up, you're dealing with the anger and rage that has been built up for 6, 7 years. All I gotta say is look out, because if it is that type of guy, then you know you could end up in a bad situation. Now, I don't know how it works legally. You know, no comics want to wait till somebody swings. But
I wonder, because
it's a threat, dude.
If they step on the stage, then you should defend yourself.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. If not, if the guy goes down into the audience. But yeah, yeah.
Right, yeah. There's been those comics.
Those comics.
Who take a leap.
Here's another thing I gain respect for you. So I don't know what it is with you and tall white guys. But one time we had a whole group of tall white guys come from Fresno with their wives. Mm-hmm. And then I go, so how do you know Johnny? This is at Laugh Factory Vegas. And this big tall white dude goes, me and Johnny went to high school together, and I was behind Johnny and I was like kicking his chair. And one day Johnny just goes, he was just like, man, he was just fucking over it. And he just fucking fought me and fucking like threw down with me and fucked me up. And I go, oh shit. And now we're friends.
Yeah.
And they came down to our show with their wives and we had a great time.
He's like 6'6" now.
He's huge.
But he was still, I think at the time in school.
That's how you gained his respect.
But you know what it was? Yeah, yeah. I think I told you what really was happening. He kept calling me short shit, shrimp. Yeah. Baba, day after day after day.
And then it just...
And it was just that day, man. I'm sitting there, he's behind me. And he did kick my chair, though. He was doing that with his foot. And I was like, knock it off, Robbie. And he's like, what are you going to do? Nothing, you little shit.
I hope he watches this.
I should tell him. Because he's such a great guy.
He's such a cool dude. We were drinking with him. That's why I was like, wait, so how do you know Johnny?
The night. We ended up hanging out the whole night with him. But, you know, this is one of those things. He did, you know, he was always, you know, pushing on me.
Everybody has that moment.
It was just that moment. And I remember I stood up, and I remember Rob, and he was so much taller. And he's all, you ain't going to do nothing. And I just, you ever see Christmas Story? That movie, The Christmas Story?
The famous one.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, that redheaded guy that's always picking on him each day. And finally that one day he's all, boo, wah, and then he just loses it. He just starts. It was kind of of a moment. We were in, that was our freshman year in high school. We both got suspended a day or two or 2 days. I can't remember.
That's why the first time in Vegas, when you're like, no, man, fuck you, fight. And then the second time was your friend from Fresno telling me that you threw down with him. So I was surprised in Hollywood you kept it cool. Guess what? It's another tall white guy. Yeah, I was like, here comes Johnny, another tall white guy. He stood up and he was trying to rush the stage. It's crazy, dude.
You know, I don't know what that is, but I tell you, there was a guy that I used to know back in the day in school. And he would always, at parties, big, tall, white dude.
Yeah.
Would always kind of like nitpick. And I was like, what's, you know. And then I found out later on that he had gotten jumped by some Mexican dudes. So like sometimes, I remember one time going on stage, I'll never forget this, at the Long Beach Laugh Factory, three people in the front. A guy, his chick, and then his buddy next to him. And the dude had long hair. And I got on stage, and it was a weeknight, and I started, and immediately the guy just turns and just starts talking to them. And I was like, whoa, I'm sorry, man. Are you guys okay here? I don't know. And he's like, yeah, we're fine, man. And then he just starts talking. I was like, why are you talking? I just got up here, dude. What are you going to... You know what he says? He goes, like, you got a problem with me? He goes, yeah, I just don't like you, man.
Why?
I go, you don't like me? I go, I just stepped up here. He's like, I don't know, man. Don't like you. And, you know, that happens. Sometimes, maybe I reminded him of somebody. Maybe he thought I was, I don't know, didn't like my voice.
Some people are just dicks.
It's just the way it is. That's just, and I mean, that was a rough set because then I was like, well, you might have to go sit in the back. You're going to have to leave. I can't do my show that I know. You know, and I try to make light of it. Like, well, I don't like dudes with long hair and, you know, whatever. And, but what do you do, man? Sometimes you're going to get people who just don't like you. I know that happens with female comics, too. Women, I think sometimes even more so than a female comic will go up on stage. And there's certain girls, if she's too hot, then the girl's just looking at her, you know, her man. Are you looking at her because she's funny or you looking at her ass? And her tits.
I feel, for me, it's Asian dudes. Some Asian dudes are cool. Usually, like, the more, like, nerdy ones, they like me.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But the ones who are a little, like, too cool for school, they always look at me like, man, fucking, you're not that funny. Or I'm funnier than you. I get that vibe.
Yeah.
Or especially if they're with their girl.
Yeah.
And then old white men, they don't like me. I don't know why. I think they have this feeling of, like, when did Asians become funny? Like, they grew up where Asians are, you know, like, fucking China, man. You know, like, we were just, like, a...
And you don't have an accent.
Yeah.
You're just speaking...
And actually, especially if... Even if I'm making fun of Asians, if I'm starting to do well, I notice old white men, they kind of look at me like, what? Like, times are changing. Like, they have this feeling of, like, insecurity. Like, how the hell? Because I'm at weddings, and sometimes, you know, I do my, if you're feeling, I do my same shit. But, you know, it does well. And I have old white men, they always come up to me at weddings. Always old men, they go, so, what are you, like, a comedian or something? Like, do you this? And then I go, oh, yeah, I should do stuff. He goes, that explains it. I know you just couldn't be, like, I couldn't be just, like, an Asian MC that's funny. Like, and I'm like, damn, man. Like, it's just like.
And they don't even get what they're saying. They have no idea
it's
how
like appalling
to them.
Like, they're like, whoa, like, who is this Asian guy? And I'm like, dude, I'm fucking almost 40. It's not like I'm some Asian kid. Like, I'm like, dude, it's like, man, it's crazy. Yeah. That's why I went. Oh, yeah, yeah.
No, but I get that too. But of course, you know, it's tough sometimes doing a Latino room, dude.
Oh, yeah.
When you got the, those dudes.
Oh,
this
fool
ain't funny, bro.
Yeah.
He's all funny, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
Let's bring him down to Pacoima, bro. You know, that I got to deal with that sometimes.
Yeah.
Anyway, you're gonna...
No. This is what Johnny reintroduced to me is... I don't know if they're going to be able to hear it.
Ancient Chinese
secret. There
you go.
We
need more. We need more Calgon towards the end.
The video is not showing.
Let's not worry about the video. They can find it on YouTube, by the way.
Fuck it. Never mind. There's a video.
Yeah,
where
just tell them to go. It's Calgon. It's Calgon. A '70s. You got to put in '70s Calgon commercial, or you can put in '70s. You can put in Calgon Ancient Chinese Secret. And it's so horrible.
It's crazy.
But it was everybody's favorite commercial back then.
It's pretty racist now. Yeah.
Well, they're at a lot. Well, first of all,
Is it a dry cleaning store or is it their house? Because
it's just
think about
it. They filmed it at home.
Because think about it. The lady goes, it looks like it's not a dry cleaning place.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then the wife turns around behind the curtain.
Yeah.
And all she's next to is a washer and dryer.
That's it.
Not a
dry cleaner.
Or any, yeah. And she's like, my husband, some hot shot.
And then all of a sudden a white woman's in there.
And that's what I'm saying. Yeah, the white lady's in there.
It's supposed to represent a dry cleaner, but it's actually just a home.
It's just a home. So really what they're saying is, these people were doing people's laundry at their house in the 70s.
And what's the secret?
And then it's Calgon.
It's ancient Chinese and then secret.
That's the best line as a lady's leaving. The wife. We need more Calgon.
Yeah, yeah.
Ancient Chinese secret. Huh? I mean, classic, dude.
That's why when it explains of how much the world has changed, why...
That would get pulled immediately.
Oh, now.
There would be marches. Yeah, yeah.
But no, how much, why, like, when I see, like, old white men, they kind of look at me, like, they never laugh at my shit, like, you know? Well, rarely. Sometimes they do. Yeah, yeah. But it's just a whole different, you know.
But there is. You get that sometimes. And look, and black comedy is a part of American comedy.
Yeah.
So blacks have been doing comedy for so long that it's already a staple. It's already it's established, and everybody they're totally cool with it. Everybody in America, any black comedian going on stage or you know whatever, it's just kind of like they've been doing it for so many decades that it's become you know synonymous. Black comics and white comedians and Jewish comedians are part of the staple of the. History of comedy in America.
Yeah, yeah.
Now the rest of us have all been jumping on board in the last couple decades.
True.
You know, you've got Paul Rodriguez and Freddie Prinze and these guys in that were starting in the 70s. But I mean, think about it. That up until then, there was no Middle Eastern comics back then. There was no Asian comics back then. There was a little bit in the late 80s with Henry Cho.
Yeah, yeah.
And Margaret Cho.
Yeah, yeah.
But if you really look at the comedy scene, the full mix of everybody has been the last 20 years and really the last 10.
Yeah.
I mean, I start seeing guys go, what's it? Oh, I'm Lebanese, man. Wait, what? And then some other dude goes, no, man, I'm actually Moroccan. I'm actually, you know, and they're saying things. I'm going, I never ran into any comics of this many races before.
Yeah, yeah. People don't even know. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, right. Some that you just are like, oh, wow.
I remember Tony Rock went, what the fuck is Armenian? He didn't even know what the race was.
There you go. When we were starting in it was like the right around the mid-90s, I never ran into an Armenian, Persian, Egyptian comics, none of them. Yeah. Palestinian, none. And then I saw Maz Durrani and Ahmed first, actually. Around 90, maybe 97 or 98, I met him. And then...
Who you wrestled.
Who I wrestled with, and he's 6'2".
Not white, not a tall white dude.
No, strong Egyptian dude. But you know what I'm saying? Like that, like... And now it's just... But then, you know what? The only bad thing is in my opinion, the problem with all these... all the diverse comedians is now we started having segregated shows. Because you could do... An Asian night.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
A Middle Eastern night.
Yeah.
And then you start having, you know, that Latino night and Armenian night. That's the only bad thing I've noticed that because there's so many, it's so easy to just go, well, why don't we just do one thing?
Gay night. Yeah.
Oh, I love the name of the one. The one night, in Long Beach. Cirque du Soleil.
Is that what it's called?
Yes. Cirque du Soleil. I gotta give props on the name.
Yeah, yeah.
You know I like wordplay and puns and stuff.
I ran Asian night here for a long time. That's like one of my.
And now it's just a regular night.
Yeah,
and
just a regular
and it's
night.
Funny
it's
because
cool,
although the Asian crowds were always great.
Yeah, yeah.
But
not
but
all. That, most of the time.
Most of the time, but that's how it should be. Like it should be you, an Asian guy, hosting just. A show.
Yeah, yeah.
Where everybody can come and then everybody on the show is going to be a mix.
People usually get pissed when there's two Asians in a row, though.
I know, that's always so funny.
It's always true.
I used to like it back when, like, it would be you, Katie, and Daniel, and then one of us would finally go up.
And then, you know,
we'd be remember, like, well, it was a long time ago. Asia and I was just me hosting and Dane Cook. It would be like me, some could be like a midnight show because Dane was working out his stuff, and they would call it Asian Night. And it was just me, and then Dane would do like an hour.
Because couldn't his last name be
Cook?
Yeah. Mm, is there? No.
No. Cook.
You know what? I always wanted to. I remember back in the day, right when he had really hit with everything, I was trying to find an Asian dude who was supposed to be from another, like he's the same, it's like a mirror, but from another country, where he moved and talked just like, but his name was Kane Duk.
Kane Duk.
C-A-N-E-D-O-O-K. If you flip the letter. And he was just, you know, he was like that, like, but he did it in his, how great of a sketch would that have been at the time? An Asian dude, same hair, dressed just like Dane, but he spoke either Korean or Japanese or whatever.
Kane Duk,
dude.
For the record, I do want to say here at the world famous Laugh Factory, I know like everybody has their own opinion and he's one of the, you know, world's most famous comedians. Like in the beginning, he was so cool to me, man, Dane Cook. And he would always, like, I would email him and he would email me back.
Yeah.
And I would actually be like, whoa.
Yeah.
Because he was doing arenas.
Yeah.
And then he'd be like, yo, like, hey, buddy, you know. I'm like, damn. And I saved all those.
That's
like,
great.
Like, it would make me feel like, at least I'm on this level. Like, I would feel like all you guys, the headliners, were in this house party. And I just open the door, and I'm just inside. But I'm fucking in. Like, I'm in. And there's all these other open micers and thousands of fucking hate. They're all looking like inside.
Outside.
Like, but I'm
with
fucking,
the bouncer, with the rope.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm in. Like, yeah. I just got in.
Just as long as you're in. But, you know, he was always, I mean, listen, he was always nice to me.
Yeah.
We never, but, you know, we were so completely opposite as well. And that always makes a difference, too. I think sometimes when, listen, there's a lot of Latino comics that have beefs with each other.
How come, you don't have to say if you don't want, how come the Latino comedians, they don't like Ernie G?
Well,
I'll tell you the background. Ernie G, long time ago, there was a show called Ed McMahon's Next Big Star. It was supposed to be the Star Search, but it was on PAX.
Yeah,
Family Channel, nobody watches Clean.
I remember.
So I applied. I got on. It was filmed in Vegas. The first round, it was this old white bald dude, and he was talking so much shit. At that time, you know, I took a, you know, my previous girlfriend, we were there, and he was just like, yeah, because I just started. And he was like patting him on my back like, yeah, you know, don't worry. Like, you know, this is just the beginning. He was already telling, like, he's already acting like he's going to beat me, right? He's like, don't worry, buddy. Like, you know, you're.
Is this Ernie G?
No, this is the old white guy.
Oh.
So, and then he's like, don't worry, you know, everybody has to start somewhere, whatever. And then it's audience vote. They press a button, A or B, whatever. And I won, right? Fucking beat that old white dude. And then we got in a van. And then it's a 15-minute ride back from the theater set back to where we go back. It's longest.
The two of you only?
At least I thank God I had my girlfriend. And there was like a PA and like the driver. And he couldn't say a word, right? And I was like, I can't believe I won, right? This is like the beginning of my career. And then the round two, we came back, you know, a few hours later for the next round. And then I lost to Ernie G. And I don't know why all these Latino comedians don't like him. And you're like, you fucking lost to Ernie G? I'm like, that was like the beginning of my comedy career.
I knew him for years. I just think he made some
enemies.
He just made some bad choices along the way, and I think in this business, man, you've got to not just always worry about yourself and what's going to benefit you, and when you do that, you're gonna lose respect, you're gonna lose people's friendships, and he knows he made bad choices.
Oh, did he?
Yeah,
he was always cool to me. Like, I
nice guy. He's a really nice dude, but I just think, you know, I'm sure if he could go back, he would probably do it different as well.
Yeah,
I'm pretty sure.
It's so funny because people don't know, like, you know, whatever your field you're in, I'm sure. Yeah, it's all good. It's sports. It's like sportsmanship is good. But you're tied to that person forever. And even though I haven't seen him yet, whenever I see like him doing stuff, I'm always inside for fun. I'm like, fucking Ernie.
Yeah.
I lost to Ernie.
Yeah.
There's only two people. Well, they're like, I think I've been cool with everybody. But I'll just say, I'm not going to name names again, but there's one female comedian I've shared with you. She was a judge on a very famous national comedy talent show.
Right.
And she, when I auditioned, Greg Giraldo, rest in peace, love him. He's like, awesome. Hey, man, you got a lot of potential. I did 2 minutes. And then she goes, really? Because she's trying to be like the Simon Cowell.
Yeah.
And I was like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
And then the other guy, he was like, no, he was good. He's good. He's like, yeah, keep working on your stuff. But I just remember her because it's I had brought her up. I had met her like 3 times. I had brought her up and she was just trying to get rating. It's like, it's hard not, I move on.
You never forget.
We all have pride, ego.
And, you know, and listen, that's one of those things, man. When you become some type of judge on a competition show with stand-ups, you're never going to forget what you say.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, so whenever these comics take on these, I've heard other comics say the same thing about some of the guys that were judges. Like, man, if I ever get a chance, I'm gonna pop him in this. Because, you know, you're really, especially if it's somebody who sometimes we're like, you know, they made some good and not so good choices with judges sometimes on those the competition show. So you sometimes get having somebody telling you something, you're kind of like, I don't know if you should be critiquing him or whatever. And they don't forget it. And I remember one time I was having that conversation with Sebastian Maniscalco. He asked me something about that. He's like, could you ever judge? I go, I think I could probably do it and do it the right way and be. And he's like, yeah, man. He goes, I don't know. You know, comics don't forget, you know, and he's right. Because even if you try to be, even if you were trying to be like, hey, man, it was good, but it wasn't good enough, that could be something that stays with that comic. 10 years later, he's on a TV show. Somebody brings up your name. No, he's not auditioning for this show. The guy that critiqued me, that said it wasn't, I mean, you just don't know, man.
Just comes back.
Yeah.
I love,
not worth it.
I love Sebastian. I just saw 2 of his specials recently on YouTube, like beginning to end. He's amazing, you know, like I just cracking up.
So good.
But even because you brought it up, I just like with this podcast, the Pinche Kimchi podcast, I just want to keep I just want to keep it real. And like, so long story short, Kim's a comedy before they were all big. Ken Jeong, Bobby, Steve Byrne, Kevin.
Yeah.
They did a show, Wiltern. This is right before they all went. Poof! And they asked me to promote, and we'll give you 5 minutes. It's in Koreatown. I'm like beginning of my comedy career. And, you know, I'm like pretty, you know, I have a good connection in K-Town, L.A. So I fucking promoted my ass off. Right? I'm actually glad to put this on record. I love the Kim's economy. They're like my mentors, my young, you know. But they asked me to promote my ass off, and I fucking promoted my ass off. You know, social media, whatever I could, right? That's when I first got married, I remember. So it was like 9 years ago. I'm like going crazy, but it didn't sell out. And they never contacted me. I was waiting for the, all right, you know, you're going to get your 5 minutes or whatever. I still brought a lot of people, you know, raised awareness, all did, you know, promoted. And they never contacted, the show came and then I found out Sebastian opened for, so even though Sebastian had nothing to do with it, there's that comedy pride thing. Like, people would tell me, yeah, man, PK, like, I thought you were going to open. I'm like, I thought so, too. Like, they never contacted
me. Oh, but you know what?
They apologized to me after. But then they were like, yeah, this guy Sebastian opened. He's fucking amazing, right? And so it's like, ever since then, I would see him. And then, like, and then I ran into him once here, and I was really, you know, super friendly. Maybe he was in a mood. He was just kind
of
like.
No, he's a little bit of, he'll admit it. Like, he.
Not the friendliest,
right? Yeah. He's got more of a guard up, and then
yeah,
when he first meets people.
So I was kind of like, oh, okay. So it's like, you know, you just have to like let those things go because it's like,
well, you gotta
remember, he has nothing to do with it.
No, but you got to remember, yeah, he was pretty tight with Steve.
Bobby. And Bobby too, right?
And Steve Byrne.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And they were all working at the store together, at the comedy store. So that probably had something.
But there's that taste of Hollywood too where like, how come nobody contacted me?
Yeah, it's terrible.
Like, I busted my ass for 5 minutes. And then so, like, you have to let those things go because ever since then, they've always been cool to me. Like, I love them all. Like, all of them. They've always been cool. I've opened for all of them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I went to Korea with Kevin. But, like, so it's just that pride, though. You have to let it go. because you and Bobby, I had this little tiny cable show, Mnet.
Oh, yeah.
It was like small viewerships, like an MTV Asia, a Korea thing. And then you guys came through. Bobby came through, so I appreciated it. But then one time I opened for Bobby at Laugh Factory in Long Beach, and he had just come back from like South Africa.
Yeah.
And you were always like, hey, do
something. Where he got mugged.
You always do time. He goes, PK, but just don't do time. I go, what? I drove down here from Glendale, man. He's like, I just came from South Africa. Fuck that, I came from Glendale. I'm like, I'm gonna do my 10 minutes. Like, damn, like, don't do no time. It's like you always, in this industry, you always have to like swallow your pride. That's so hard.
It is hard.
You are like one of the most talented people ever, and you got on Mad TV, and it's so unfortunate right before it ended.
Right before it ended.
It must have ate you up.
Killed me. Because I could have done at least minimum of 5 seasons. Because that was the
kind. I remember Lil Joker was starting to blow, yeah. And then the whole thing ended.
And then it just ended. Now, there is a little. Maybe I better not say anything. But I think there's the owners might be wanting to try to shop it around. But I think if they were to do that, though, they would start over. You know, they're going to start over with a brand new cast. I couldn't see them bringing people that were on it before. I think you have to, just like in Living Color tried to do. But the problem with that was those guys all knew each other. They were all friends for the most part. So they were all working at the Comedy Store together. That's different. When they tried to recast it, you know, that's lightning in a bottle. I don't know how you catch it. Mad TV, it was a revolving door of people. It wasn't really like a family. Some stayed for years, but it was still revolved. There was always somebody coming in almost every single year. Somebody would get booted, somebody would come in. Every year. But it sucked. Like I would have been happy with even just 4 seasons. I mean, I got 2, but I think 2 more, and I would have been more recognizable. I think it would have really helped me a little bit more after it got canceled. But I just did the 2 seasons. You got to remember, the ratings were already really dipping by the time I got on.
Oh, yeah. So that's, it sucks, man.
Yeah, dude. But you know what? I guess
not enough people got to see your characters. You know,
but I got on because think about it. What if I hadn't? I wouldn't even have, I mean, I've got tons of television credits and guest starring things and all that, but I wouldn't even have that. So I kind of look and I go, you know what? I'll take it. 2 seasons on a hit. It was a hit
Ozzie
show.
Gian, amazing.
Ozzie was fantastic.
Yeah, you do Carlos, George Lopez.
You did. I did Lopez, yeah. Mencia.
Al Pacino, right?
I did Pacino.
Yeah, yeah. Little Joker is the best.
Little Joker was my guy. But Ozzie Guillen was that one that...
And it was hot at that time.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And we knocked it out of the park.
Yeah, man. It went viral. Yeah, yeah.
It went viral. And that, I remember doing that live one take, dude. One take live. And they were like, we don't even need to do another. I was like, are you sure? And they're like, no, this is... You know, and that was me. I got together with one of the writers. It was his idea, though. I got to give him credit. He asked me if I could do Ozzy. I was like, I don't know. He basically just asked he wrote the reporter's questions, and I wrote all the answers, Ozzy's answers, all the cussing and all I'm the one that came up with the light bulb, the ET flipping off with the light bulb and all that stuff like that. We were going to do another one, and then the show got canceled. But we wanted to do another one, like keep this thing going with. And then, you know, there was the Dr. Oz show.
You know the Dr. Oprah Dr. Oz?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So then I was like, I got it. We're going to do the Dr. Ozzy show. Ozzy Guillen.
That would have been amazing.
Dude, he's there telling people what to eat, what not to, but he's cussing the whole, wait a minute, I should still do it. What am I talking about?
Yeah, I know, you should still do it.
He's not, the problem is he's not
as relevant anymore.
He's not as relevant.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But you could do anybody. You know, my friend Jay, I know you're annoyed that I can't make your other show on February.
Totally kidding.
But he's the one that saw you at Laugh Factory Vegas, and he goes, honestly, he's the funniest comedian I've ever seen. So I remember telling you that.
Yeah.
And my friend Jay has come here a lot. He's seen a lot of people.
Yeah.
And I think so too, man. So.
Well, thanks, dude.
For sure.
Are we cutting it?
No, no. What's what else was coming up for you? Where can people normally see you?
Well,
when all million people see the Pinche Kimchi podcast.
That's right, the Pinche Kimchi. You know, this is my second home, pretty much. Laugh Factory and Sunset or Long Beach. And I don't know, how does this work? When is this going to go up, do you
Probably
think?
Like a week from now.
Oh, yeah, I'll be at the, I'll also be at the Ice House on February 26th, which you could have been with me, but you'll do the next one. But I'll be there Friday night, a 10 o'clock show. I got the late spot, late show. There's an 8 and it's 10, or 8:15, 10:15, whatever. Mm-hmm. So I'll be doing that, and then and I'm going on the road next week doing... I'm performing at the Selena Auditorium. This might not air. I don't know. When will this air?
Probably a week from now. Yeah, I'm not sure.
Okay.
I don't have the power.
Well, February 13th, I'll be in Corpus Christi at the Selena. What's her? Selena. Just Selena. What was her last name?
You mean Selena Gomez. You mean the singer Selena?
Yeah, Selena.
I don't know. It's just Selena.
Selena. Yeah. She just went to Selena. Her that little auditorium thing. So, so we good?
Yes. Thank you.
Thanks for having me. First one, man.
The very first. I don't know how many we're gonna do, but
the first of three.
The trilogy.
The trilogy. But all right, brother.
Thank you, bro.
You got it.
Love you.
And then play us out with, are you feeling me?
Sit still. If you're feeling me, sit still. Just breathe. Blink. Stare. And think. Keep your hands down. Keep your hands down. Keep your hands down.
All right, brother. Thanks, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.